All right, if you want to follow along in your book, it's your volume 4, chapter 2, pages 144 through 175. Now, there is a section on MI stuff that's previous that we went over a week or two ago, and it kind of coincides with the 12-lead stuff as well. There's going to be some new concepts and new terms that we're going to talk about today. So the purpose of a 12-lead to perform an EKG is a further look in the heart. We know that typically we can easily access a quick look at the electrical conduction of the heart through our limb leads and get a quick look. Our limb leads are leads 1, 2, and 3, and then you've got your augmented leads, your AVR, AVL, and AVF. Why is it that lead 2 is usually a good lead just to get a basic look at the electrical current or the electrical flow of the heart? Right, where's the positive lead in lead 2? Left leg. Where's the negative lead?
Right
shoulder. So, one of the things we've got to keep in mind whenever we're looking at 12 leads is that we're getting a picture from different angles of the heart, and the flow of current is always pictured going towards the positive lead. So, essentially in lead 2, I've got a camera on the left leg that's taking a picture from the left leg to the right arm, and it's showing the current that's coming towards the camera. Alright? Does that make sense? Each lead that we're going to put on in a 12 lead takes a different look or a different angle of the heart. Now, your 12 lead that you're used to doing, where you put V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, that is mainly to get a further picture of which part of the heart? The left ventricle. Now, we will talk briefly about how to get a 12 lead concerning the right side of the heart. But typically, whenever we do a 12 lead, it's getting a picture of the left side of the heart. Now, your limb leads take a picture on the frontal plane, and then we start moving more towards the lateral side of the left ventricle as we're getting our different leads. So the purpose of today's lecture, the purpose of us bringing up 12 lead in this class, because at the end of the day, this class is rhythm interpretation and cardiac management. When you get out of this class, I'm not expecting you to be an expert on 12-lead EKGs. But what I am expecting you to do is be familiar where the leads are placed and what we're looking at briefly on a 12-lead printout so that we can mainly spot MI quickly. And we talked about the reason why it's important for us to spot MI quickly and to understand what part of the heart the MI is occurring. But to understand how this sheet of paper that prints off with leads 1 all the way to V6 works, we've got to understand the cardiac conduction system, which we've already went over before and we'll review briefly, but we've got to understand how the electricity flows through the heart so that we can identify when it's not flowing correctly. We're going to take a quick look at axis determination, cardiac axis, and axis, the axis of the heart. We're going to look at the axis of the QRS, and basically it's just taking a look at the flow of electricity. Is it going at a normal angle, or is it deviated, and it's going more towards one side or the other side of the heart? And then we're going to look at some basic alterations of ventricular conduction, bundle branch blocks, and things like that. Also, quick identification of ischemia, injury, and infarction. And then we're going to talk about ACS management. And again, you're not expected to be an expert at 12-lead interpretation, but you are supposed to come out of this class with at least a entry-level knowledge of a 12 lead and understanding as a paramedic, when should I hook a 12 lead up and what can I look for? So the first thing I want to do is go back and review our leads. Our limb leads, they're called bipolar leads. Why are they bipolar leads? Because we put a positive and negative lead and the cardiac monitor determines which lead is going to be positive and negative. It uses two leads. You've always got to have a positive and a negative in order to get a picture. So your bipolar leads are going to be leads 1, 2, and 3, AVR, AVL, and AVF. Now why do we say AVR, AVL, AVF? What does that A stand for? Augmented. So the reason why it is augmented is because if by its own, by the amount of electricity that is produced when we look in AVR, AVL, and AVF, we would not be able to see a good waveform. So what the monitor has to do is increase the amplitude of those waveforms so that we can see them on the 12-lead ECG. So leads 1, leads 2, leads 3, AVR, AVL, and AVF, they form what's called Einthoven's triangle. You remember Einthoven's triangle? And essentially, you have you got your right arm lead, your left arm lead, your left leg lead, and your right leg. All right, but mainly we use these three, right? So we form. You got your heart right here. Essentially what's happening is that it's not necessarily a perfect triangle, but they say a triangle as a reference. So if I'm looking from my right arm to my left leg, essentially what I'm doing is looking at the cardiac conduction system from the right atria down through the ventricles and all that, all right? So this would be, if the positive in this case is on the left leg, the negative is the right arm, this would essentially be the right side of the triangle is going to be what? Lead 2. All right? So, our left arm lead, if it is negative and then left leg is positive, we're looking this way from the right side of the heart down, and that's our lead 3. And then lead 1 is taking more of an approach from the right arm to the left arm. All right? And so essentially it would form Einthoven's triangle. Does that make sense? Now, once you include AVR, AVL, and AVF, you have what's called the hexaxial reference system, where it's going to be, we're looking at it from just a slightly different angle. And so we've got a different line that we're going down. So it would make 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 viewpoints. Makes it hexaxial. And we'll talk about that again in just a minute. Your precordial leads. They're also called unipolar leads. They're also called chest leads. That's going to be your what leads? V1 through V6. So these are going to take an extra step for us to get these precordial leads. And initially, if we're just putting them like we've learned how to put them, we're taking a look on the left side of the heart. It's placed on the anterior and lateral chest walls. So it starts on the anterior, moves to the lateral, and it looks at the heart on a horizontal plane. All right? Now, they are called unipolar. Why are they called unipolar? Y'all know? If you think about some rough drawing, if you think about the way that these work, you've got V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. They're all going to a central place, and the positive is right there in the heart. Okay? So they only require one lead. However, the monitor itself will make the positive and negative. All right? Now, I know that's a little bit of a deeper thought, and that's not the purpose of all of this. I want you to just understand that unipolar, it just requires one lead in order for you to get what you need. Okay? So, your leads, you've got your bipolar or your limb leads, and then you've got your precordial or unipolar or chest leads. I don't know if you can see this very well, but essentially what we're doing is we're taking a picture on a horizontal plane of the left ventricle. So we're looking here, 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 and here. All right? So there is an acronym that can help you remember the areas of the heart that your precordial leads will take a picture of. LISA. You got your lateral, inferior, septal, and what? Anterior. Now, your inferior leads, we're going to use our chest leads for those. But your lateral, septal, we're going to use our bipolar leads for your inferior views. But your lateral, septal, and anterior leads are all precordial views. So this is just a view of how your precordial leads should be placed, and I know that you've probably done this several times. General rule of thumb, though, is to place V1, V2, V4, and then go back and place V3 directly in the center of V2 and V4. You want to make sure that the chest is clean, dry, and those leads stick good. And you want to make sure that all movement has stopped in the back of the truck, all movement with the patient has stopped as you're acquiring the 12 lead. Again, this is just another view of what we're looking at. All this stuff kind of goes with what we've already talked about before. You want to try your best to have that as close as you can, all right, to a good placement, because slight alterations can make a little bit of a difference when it comes to size of waveforms. And that's ultimately what we're looking at. We're looking at alterations and sizes of waveforms. In some situations, we may be looking for a unique type of waveform. But in most situations, whenever we are looking at a 12 lead, we're just looking at the P, Q, R, S, and T waves. And we're just trying to see the size of them and where they are in relation to the isoelectric line. Some of your basic electrophysiology or cardiac electrical management concepts. When a current moves toward a lead, it creates a positive deflection, right? So if I've got a positive QR complex, then that means that electrical current is flowing towards that positive electrode. When I start going negative with my S, that means that briefly that current has went back up. Does that make sense? And it makes sense in the way that the electrical current flows in the heart, right? Because it starts in the SA node and it goes down to the AV node and it hits the bundle branches and then it branches off, right and left bundle branch, and then it has to come back up through the fascicles and through the Purkinje fibers. It has to come back up away from the positive electrode in order to finish depolarizing the rest of the heart. So that's going to be important when we look at certain leads in a 12 lead, is determining, is it positive or negative? Is the deflection positive or negative? And so the way you do it is you look at the isoelectric line, and if you've got a upward deflection, then that means it's going towards your lead. Or if you've got a downward deflection, that means it's going away from the lead. Now, that's not a bad thing in a lot of situations, right? Because that's just a normal process of the way that the heart works. So what do all these lines right here mean? What do these arrows mean? This is going to be the picture that we take with the different leads in relation to the direction of the electrical current. All right. So if I'm doing an AVR, that means that the camera is up here. We're looking at the current going this way. Now AVR, which is your second augmented, or your second row, top augmented right there, for this class, it's going to be kind of non-existent. It's going to be kind of a lead that is useful, but not really for what we're going to be learning. All right? If I look at AVL, so I'm taking a picture and your camera's right here and so on and so forth. AVF lead 2 is going to be this way. So does that make sense? Do you see the electrical current of the heart would flow that way? And that's lead 2 is this way. All right, so wherever the arrow is, that's where the camera is. That's the direction of the flow that we're taking. All right, is that making sense to you so far? Yes. Yes, in a 12 lead, you're looking at the exact same current flow, right? So you're looking at the exact same impulse, you're just looking at it from a different angle, all right? It's kind of like right now, all of y'all are looking at me teaching up here. I'm teaching the same material, I'm doing the same thing. But you've got a different view of the board, you've got a different view of the board, and you've got a different view of the board, a different perspective. All right? Why is that important? Is because when we look at a lead 2 only, all we're looking at is just the normal path of flow. But we also need to see what's happening in the ventricles. And then sometimes we need to see what's happening in the atria. And so it gives us just a different view of the same electrical current that's being produced. You do not have 12 different electrical currents that are flowing right now. You've got one, and the monitor is going to get a snapshot of each one of the leads, and that's the way it prints off right here. All right? But when we are looking at this, we know that normal current, normal flow goes from base to apex, right? So that's why when it flows towards lead 2, you've got a positive deflection. But then look up here at AVR. It's going pretty much polar opposite. That view is pretty much polar opposite. So when it takes a picture, is taking a picture of that current from this angle, but that current is flowing away from it, and so that's why it's a negative deflection. Does that make sense? And you'll see that when we start looking at some of these leads, you'll see that the size of the complex gets either bigger and bigger and bigger, or smaller and smaller and smaller as you get pictures of the different areas of the heart. Okay? So, what I want to do right now is I want you to get this sheet right here. And I want you to get your pen. And what I actually want to do, let me find this. Get this thing to ride on here. Alright. So what I want you to do is take your pen. We're going to draw on this. We're going to look. Now, yours is a little bit different, but it's still the same concept. The first thing I want you to do is find AVR and V1, and I want you to draw a line right down the middle. Just like that. And that's going to split your 12 lead into the types of leads that we're looking at. On the left side, I want you to write limb lead. And then on the right side, or I guess it would be your, anyways, this side, I want you to write chest or precordial lead. All right? Now what we're going to do is kind of map this out by our own hand and looking at it so that we can understand in relation to the heart what we're looking at on this sheet of paper, because what this is a map of the heart. And so if we can understand what leads go where, then we can understand what location we're looking at. So the first thing I want you to draw around, I want you to find leads 2, 3, and AVF. And I want you to kind of make a just a little circle around leads 2, 3, and AVF. So we're starting with the left leg view, all right? So we're going to start with the positive electrode on the left leg. And so leads 2, 3, and AVF have a positive electrode on the left leg. So it's actually taking a picture from the left leg. All right? So this is going to be the inferior wall of the left ventricle. So what do I mean by inferior? Be taking a look more towards the bottom. All right. This, and it's also very important that you understand which areas of the heart are being supplied by which coronary arteries, because when we take a look at if they have an MI, then it will help us to kind of differentiate the magnitude of the MI, depending on the artery that's supplying it. So your inferior wall of your left ventricle is typically supplied by your right coronary artery. All right. The next area that we're going to look at is leads 1, AVL, and V5 and V6. But first, let's just make a circle around leads 1 and AVL. All right. Leads 1 and AVL are going to take a look at the high lateral wall. So the higher lateral or side wall of the left ventricle. All right. And they are going to be supplied by your circumflex, typically, by your circumflex artery. Now, the reason why I wanted to say let's go ahead and move over to V5 and V6 is because it's in the same general area, except it's going to be the lower lateral wall. So with the low lateral wall, because the anatomy of the heart is so vast and complex, there's not just one particular artery that supplies the low lateral wall. It could be any of the arteries. All right. The next two that I want to look at is V1 and V2. V1 and V2. These are going to take a look at the septal wall. Alright, so what do I mean by septal wall? That thick tissue right there, the intraventricular septum. Alright, and this is supplied by your left anterior descending artery, or your LAD. All right, then another group that we want to look at is going to be your V3 and your V4. V3 and V4 are looking at your anterior section. And then The last part, AVR and V1 together, also can take a look at your base or the upright part of the heart. All right? And they are supplied by the, especially AVR, proximal LCA, left coronary artery. Now, these, the LAD, left anterior descending, your proximal LCA, all those, they are actually branches of your left coronary artery. Remember, when it comes to a coronary clot, the lower the clot is in the coronary arteries, the better off they are going to be, right? Because if you've got a clot in the high left coronary artery, you've possibly just lost blood flow to 80% of your heart. The LCA is affectionately known as the widow maker, right? Because it supplies the main amount of myocardial oxygen in blood. Okay? So, when we move on into 12-lead identification and all that, we're looking not just as one strip, but we're looking at topographical areas of the heart. And we're looking for subtle changes, or maybe not subtle, maybe big changes. And we're looking in these different areas, so if I've got ST elevation in V1 and V2, then I'm thinking, hey, I've got an issue in the septal wall. I'm losing blood supply in the septal wall. Does that make sense? All right. So all of your 12 leads are going to be printed off in that same manner. Now, one thing that I've told y'all before, and I think it's on the bottom of your strip too, like when you do static cardiology and things like that, if you get a 12 lead, always look down here at this initial 6-second strip on the bottom, which is usually going to be lead 2. Look at that initially. And then move forward from there. Remember, you're usually going to have a print-off of a lead 2 on the bottom. But you may have an MI over on the lateral wall and never even see ST elevation or any changes in lead 2, which is our common lead that we're going to be putting on, right? And so that's why, if any indication of cardiac issue, we do a 12 lead so that we can get a better view of the heart. And again, this is just the print-off of it. Here's the thing about a 12-lead. There's so many times that with 12-lead, we make it super-duper complex and get very intimidated by it. But at the end of the day, if we can spot our basic changes, it's no different than interpreting a rhythm in lead 2. We've just got 12 other areas that we're trying to take a look in. We're still looking for waveforms. We're still looking for changes. We can't always depend on that machine to analyze the data and give us a correct interpretation. We need to make sure that we agree with what the interpretation of the 12 lead from the machine says. Another way to remember this is I see all leads, inferior, septal, anterior, and lateral. So, just really quickly, when we look at a 12 lead, we want to make sure that the ambulance is not moving, that we're acquiring that 12 lead, and it's a stable 12 lead. When it prints off, look at it. Did all the leads print? Because sometimes it will acquire and print off a strip, but it may be missing V1 and V2 or V3 or something like that because the lead came off or it couldn't get a good reading. A 12 lead's not any good to you if you can't get a full tracing of it. Is artifact present? It picks up very easily on artifact. That's why you want your patient motionless. Doesn't take 10 seconds for it to acquire. You want them motionless. And then is the rate at one of the extremes? So the first thing that we're looking at is the rate. Is it tachycardic or bradycardic? Are we going to have to do basic rhythm management before we can get in and start doing a lot of interpretation of the 12 lead? And then we're going to look at all of our complexes just like we would look at it in a 12 lead, I mean in a 2 lead. But now we're just taking a more of a broad look. All right. If we can make it through axis determination, if we can make it through this little section right here without you just ready to get some razors out and cut me, then we're going to be all right the rest of the lecture. This is one of the areas that, for some reason, we always just freak out over. I'm not expecting you to be an expert in axis determination. One of the problems is that there's all these numbers. You've got positive degrees and negative degrees and all that kind of stuff. What the axis is essentially the average flow of the electrical current and the degree path that it's taking. Axis is seen through what's called a vector. A vector is the force and the magnitude, or a vector is the magnitude and direction of the electricity. So the amount and the path that it's traveling. All right? And we're going to just look at an average vector. So at any given time, the heart can have millions of vectors. All right? What I mean by that is that anything that creates an electrical flow, which is every single one of the myocardial cells at some point or another, is going to have a vector. But the way that we determine the vector, or the way that we look at axes is that we average all that and we look at the general direction in which the electrical current is being generated and flow. All right? And we're mainly looking at the QRS axis, or we're mainly looking at which way is the electrical current flowing through the QRS. I think I've mentioned it in here before. But when electrical current is going through the heart, if an area of the heart has a lot of muscle, it's going to require more electricity to make that muscle contract, right? So essentially, the more muscular a ventricular wall is, the more it's going to attract that flow towards that ventricular wall. Y'all following me still? But let's just say that instead of it becoming muscular and demanding all this electricity, it's actually infarcted. And it can't do anything with the electricity. What do you think will happen to the electricity, the current? is going to be deflected away from that wall. All right? All right, you ready? So what we're looking at is the average flow of the heart. Now we want it to be at about a 59 or 60 degree angle. And I'm going to show you this angle in just a minute. But that's the normal flow of the heart. That's our electrical conduction system. All right, that means that if we've got a axis of that's going down this way at about 59 or 60 degrees, that means that the electricity is not deviating away from the normal power line system, right? It's not deviating away from the SA, the atria, the AV node, the bundle of His, the right and left bundle branches. It's staying in line on the path that it needs to go to have a good full myocardial contraction. Think about this, and I don't think I'm going to be able to write, but your SA node is usually about right here. And it supplies the atria, and you got your AV node, then your bundle of His, your left and right bundle branches, right? So this arrow right here is just indicating that in this heart, we've got an average electrical flow down that normal pathway. And it's really going to be more towards, that's not a normal, it's going to be more towards right in here, right? So you got your, you've got your SA node, you got your AV node, and you got your bundles and all that. So you want the average flow to be about 60 degrees, all right? So it's measured from 0 to 180 and then negative 30 to 180. Essentially, you've got four quadrants, all right? I hear that huffing and puffing back there. All right. So think about it like this. Let's just think about this is our ventricles right here. I don't really know how to draw this real well. All right, that's your right ventricle, that's your left ventricle. Up here is the rest of your heart, all right? We want that flow of electricity to go down the intraventricular septum, all right, and then go and supply the rest of the ventricles. If, let's say that I've got left ventricular hypertrophy, the muscle in my left ventricle has gotten very, very thick and it's requiring more electricity, then instead of that electrical current flowing down that normal 59 or 60 degree angle, it's going to start being drawn more towards the left side of the heart. All right? Or on the flip side, if I've got left-sided ischemia or infarct, it may start being drawn more towards the right side of the heart. All right? And that's essentially what axis is. You've got all these numbers, all these negative degrees and stuff like that. Yeah, I would love for you to be an expert in axis deviation and teach me the rest of it. All right? But essentially what you need to understand is that the current flows on a normal axis. or a direction, the vector. It goes normally. But if you've got an issue with the left or right ventricle, it may draw the electricity more away from the normal axis or deflect it and push it to the other side away from the normal axis. All right? And so then you're going to have issues with your contraction. You're not going to get a good full solid contraction. Now the way that we can determine this really easy without drawing a whole bunch of things and all that is just to look at is just to look at some QRS complexes in certain leads. Just really quick though, right axis deviation, which means that it's going to deviate, that flow electricity is going to deviate more towards the right side, could be due to COPD and pulmonary hypertension. Why is COPD? Why would What is that disease called that affects the right side of the heart with COPD? Cor pulmonale. So pretty much one of the only times that you're going to see right-sided heart failure that's not due to left-sided heart failure, right? So if we've got hypertrophic right ventricle muscle, then we're going to have a right axis deviation. Just meaning that the electrical current has gotten through the AV node and now it's veering off because the right ventricle needs more electricity. All right? And then left axis deviation, things that would cause left ventricular hypertrophy. Increased systemic vascular resistance, right? Increased blood pressure, makes the left side of the heart work hard. Increases the muscle. And then the frontal plane is divided into four quadrants, and we're going to look at that just really quick. Most of your modern 12-lead ECGs will go ahead and give you your axis, and that's not going to be the deciding factor into how you treat your patient. But it's going to be a factor in a foundation of really understanding what's happening with the electrical current in the heart and with your 12-lead. Axis determination is an important interpretation of a 12-lead ECG. But it's not, again, going to be just one of your end-all, tell-all, oh, we've got right axis deviation, we better call a STEMI or call a cath lab quick. We're going to be looking for other things in our 12-lead, all right? So if we're looking at lead one, if, remember lead one goes from the right to the left, it's going to be positive. Our QRS would be positive if it goes towards the left arm, or negative if it's going towards the right arm. AVF, and again, it's going to be the direction in which the current is going and the angle that we're looking for, all right? You can use the quadrant system. I'm going to do the simpler way. I'm going to do this looking at leads 1 and AVF. So one of the ways that you can quickly determine axis determination is looking at lead 1 and AVF. All right? So take your paper and find lead 1, not V1, but lead 1 and lead AVF. So, how is your QRS deflected in lead 1?
Positive.
How is your QRS deflected in lead AVF?
Positive.
Positive. So, we're on a normal axis right here. Look at your interpretation, sinus rhythm. If you look, axis is deviated a little bit. On here it's 43 degrees, but just by looking at leads 1 and leads AVF, I can tell that we're on a normal current flow, all right? We haven't deviated too much off of the normal path to get a cardiac contraction. If in lead 1 we have a positive deflection, and in leads AVF we have a negative deflection, then that would indicate some type of left axis deviation. All right. So that means that the electrical current was going down the highway and it decided to take a left towards the left ventricle. Alright, and then the same thing, you know, right axis deviation and then extreme right axis deviation. So an extreme right axis deviation would mean that we're pretty much not getting any. If you can imagine this four quadrant system on the heart and is split here or at the AV node, if you can imagine the with extreme right axis deviation, that means that it's actually pretty much going away from the normal flow of the current, and our ventricles are not getting contracted at all. So extreme right axis deviation is going to be usually caused by some type of big infarct or like severe right-sided hypertrophy. All right. Somewhat makes sense without getting too technical into the angles and the degrees and all that stuff. Yeah, a little bit. Y'all can read, you know, read over it and just kind of have in your mind what axis deviation is. That's not really what I want to spend the rest of the time on in here. Just remember, an enlarged ventricle is going to require more electrical energy. Infarcted ventricle, no electrical energy. Okay? Y'all need a break? Alright. Let's be back at 9:40. Again, this is just going to be taking a picture of the electrical activity. We've talked about before in the past how we're supposed to determine the mechanical function of the heart. But it's the signs of poor perfusion, the mechanical function of the heart, the assessment that we do that's going to clue us in into, let's go ahead and do a 12 lead, all right? Because we can't really get into the real intricacies of the coronary arteries and determine locations of infarcts and stuff like that unless we do. So one thing that I want you to see as far as a normal sinus rhythm on a 12 lead. Leads 1, 2, and 3, you've got pretty much a positive P wave, positive Q, or a positive R, and then the S is going to be coming downward, baseline, J point, and a positive T wave. All right? Also with AVS as well. If you look especially leads 2, 3 in AVF, the average direction of the electrical flow, if you went back and looked at your triangle in your reference system, is positive, right? It's going towards, all right? Come over here to V1. So V1, what do you notice about the QRS? It's negative. So the view of V1 is essentially away from your positive. But as you move around the heart, you'll start noticing that we have a somewhat positive and somewhat negative QRS. Then we become more positive QRS. Then we become more positive V4, more positive V5, and then positive in V6. All right? And so that is the evolution of the way that we're looking at your 12 lead or at your precordial leads. So as you get on towards the lateral side, they become more positive. It's more of an average direction towards the positive lead. All right?
How does a bundle branch block actually occur? Well, as you know, after an electrical impulse is conducted past the AV node, it splits at the bundle of His and continues down the right and left bundle branches simultaneously. In a healthy heart, both sides will conduct an impulse at the same time, producing a clear, unified QRS. In a heart that contains some damage to one of those pathways, the conduction will be slowed in the affected pathway. The healthy side will produce a regular QRS, but the affected side will produce another QRS that is slightly delayed. The resulting ECG tracing will be a combination of both waveforms superimposed over one another, but slightly out of sync. Here, we have a QRS wave that has resulted in the bunny ears appearance that is so often talked about. However, depending on the waveform of each QRS and how far out of sync with each other they are, it is possible for the resulting waveform to look nothing like bunny ears. Oftentimes, a waveform with an R' wave can even be mistaken as a bundle branch block. These are all examples of bundle branch blocks.
So what is, if you're going by your book, I've skipped over the myocardial stuff because I'm going to wrap up with that, the MI stuff, so we're just jumping on into bundle branch and these blocks real quick. So essentially, what is it that you're seeing when you're looking at a bundle branch block on a 12 lead? Yeah, you're seeing depolarization of both the ventricles, but at slightly different times. And so that's why you may get QRS complexes that are not uniform. All right? V1 is a good lead to look. So, a right bundle branch block. Got my SA, got my AV, bundle of His, and right side, and left side, right? So a right bundle branch block. Somewhere in this conduction pathway, there is a block. And what's possibly causing that? Ischemia, right? And so what does the heart naturally do? It reroutes that electrical flow, remember, the aberrant pathway, and then it joins back up. But as that flow is going down, it will continue to progress down on the left side because there's no block, but it'll be slightly held up on the right side. All right? So one of the ways that you can determine a right bundle branch block is going to be a R' wave, all right, an R' wave, a little notch, all right, in V1. Now, V1 is essentially located on a area that is pretty generic as far as bundle branches go, so it can take a view of the bundle branches, and so that's a good area to start your look for a bundle branch block is V1. Alright? A terminal R wave or terminal S wave would be the second half of the QRS complex terminates in an R wave or terminates in an S wave. A left bundle branch block, you'll see a terminal S wave in V1, all right? So QRS. And terminal R waves are often seen in leads 1, AVL, and V6. All right, now these are a little bit hard to kind of differentiate. But one of the biggest things that we're looking in is V1. So with a right bundle branch block, you want to look at your R wave. You've got a huge R wave, and it's positive in V1. In the left bundle branch, you've got a terminal S wave. So QR, and then you don't have much of an S, and then you've got an S here. Now, one of the ways that you can determine quickly, and it's not always the most reliable method, is using the turn signal method. If you look on page 165, if you look in V1 and you suspect you've got a bundle branch block, you can think of the turn signals. When you are driving and you hit your turn signal down, that indicates you're going what? Left. If you pop your turn signal up, that indicates you're going right, right? So you would look at your J point in V1. If the wave is negative below the J point in V1, that would be down. That would indicate a left bundle branch block. If the J point is positive, or if the wave before the J point is positive in V1, that would indicate a right bundle branch block. And then you've got a couple of other blocks that we're not going to get real deep into. Anterior fascicular blocks, posterior fascicular blocks, and again, these are going to be just extensions of the bundle branches, the fascicles. You're just going to have a block in the current of the smaller fibers that are stimulating the rest of the ventricle to contract, right? So you see here it says RS complexes or QR complexes. An RS implies an R wave of less than 5 millimeters followed by an S wave of greater than 5 millimeters. So you would have a very small R wave and a very large S wave. So if you're looking, leads 2, 3 AVF, and that QRS just doesn't look right, you can look at the R wave. It's small, but then you've got a big S wave, that could indicate some type of fascicular block. Alright? Let me not freak y'all out on these. At the end of the day, I want y'all to be able to look at a 12 lead and have an idea about bundle branch blocks, but I want you to be able to look at 12 lead and identify ST elevation and depression in the certain areas. Okay? I'm not going to test you on axis deviation and stuff like that on this next test that's coming up. As a matter of fact, there's probably 6 or 7 12 lead questions, and that's really about it. And it's mainly going to be MI treatment and the leads and things like that. Okay? Cool. You've got other pre-excitation conduction disturbances. We've talked about this before. Wolf, Parkinson, White. One of the things that we're looking for in Wolf, Parkinson, White, and we can see it in the other leads as well, is the delta wave. And then this long Guillain-Levine syndrome, and it's characterized by a short PR interval and a normal QRS duration. One of the things about WPW and LGL, these different pre-excitation syndromes is that they are prone to tachyarrhythmias. And we would treat the tachyarrhythmias if they had issues, okay? Now, another thing that we can look at, and we're going to really look at QRS complexes as far as ventricular chambers, and then we're going to look at P waves for atrial chambers as chamber size. Now, what is one of the things that I said earlier in this lecture about that thick muscle? It requires more electricity to make it contract, right? So if it's taking more current, more amperage, more voltage to make it contract, what are we going to see on an EKG? A much bigger waveform, right? A much bigger waveform. So if I was looking at atrial enlargement, which wave would be affected? The P wave. And if I'm looking at ventricular enlargement, the QRS complex. A wide R wave may indicate that a ventricle is enlarged and is taking longer to contract and more electrical current. An abnormally high R wave or an abnormally deep S wave could both indicate ventricular hypertrophy. So right atrial enlargement, often seen from chronic pulmonary disorders, we talked about the right side being affected from COPD, things like that, characterized by a huge P wave in lead 2, higher than 2.5 millimeters, and a higher P wave in V1. And I didn't put a V1. Now, one of the problems about this is that if you've got right atrial enlargement, that's going to mean that the right ventricle is probably going to have a lot of pressure pushed on it. And it could be a precursor to right ventricular hypertrophy. So, these are going to be kind of subtle, alright? But you're going to notice a P wave that just looks really big, alright? Yes?
That one right there, like lead 1, and V1, the P wave, like it goes up, then it goes down, and the QRS starts. What causes that? Is that part of the atrial?
Well, the P wave is going up, and then it's returning just back to isolation.
In the V1. It kind of goes up and then it goes down.
And it's going to be because an alteration in the direction of the flow of the atria. So if it's atrial enlargement, it's causing more electricity to go through the atrial walls. It may actually cause the electrical conduction to go down and then come back up to finish contracting the atria. Does that make sense?
So that's not indicative of like a block or anything?
Not in this one in particular. And again, your best view here for this type of thing is leads 2, 3, and AVF. V1, remember, your V leads, they're not really diagnostic of your atria. Remember, your V leads are going to be your chest leads that we're trying to get a horizontal view of the ventricle. Okay? Left atrial enlargement, again, big P waves. They're going to be longer. And then a P wave in lead V1 may be predominantly negative, so you might see that. So if you back up and we look at this, you may have right and left atrial enlargement, Jesse, because you've got a predominantly negative P wave in V1. Right? Don't just look at it as squiggly lines on a sheet of paper. Think of it in relation to where you're looking at the heart, right? So if I'm trying to determine if I've got atrial enlargement, I'm looking in the P waves, right? Now, if I've got atrial enlargement, if I've got a patient that's got atrial enlargement, am I going to do much for them? Probably not. It's just going to be something that I can show a doctor. I'm an expert at a 12 lead. Hey, looks like we've got right atrial enlargement here. If you check V2, V3, and AVF, all right? Right ventricular hypertrophy or right ventricular enlargement. What wave are we looking for? The R wave is the main one. The R wave is the main one. And you'll see. What was one of the things that we remember about a normal 12 lead with V1 as far as the QRS? It's usually a negative deflection, right? So if we see a very tall positive deflection that really doesn't change a whole lot, it gets a little bit smaller as you go to V6, then that's probably going to indicate right atrial enlargement. I mean right ventricular enlargement. And think about why. V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. V1, V2, in that area, I'm actually kind of getting a picture of the right side, right? It's mainly septal, but if I'm having electricity drawn to this side, it's going to pick it up. But as I move around to V6, it's not going to pick up the electricity as much as in V1, so I'm going to get a smaller waveform, which is opposite of what a normal 12 lead would look like. Alright, left ventricular hypertrophy. Where would you expect the tall R waves to be? V5, V6 in that area. Alright, so look at it here. V1, we're pretty negative, right? But as we move to V6, we've got tall spike R waves. Alright, does it somewhat make sense? And you've just got to think about it as a map and in relation to where you're looking in a 12 lead, alright? So if I'm looking in the lateral leads, which is on the left side, then if I've got an issue with the left side, I'm expecting to see the changes in those leads. Okay. All right. So, enough with axis, enough with bundle branch blocks and hemifascicular blocks and enlargement and all that stuff. Let's get into what we really should come out of here. I want you guys to be proficient in all of it. But this is the area where foundationally, you really need to have a good idea of how it works, okay? Most of your 12-lead interpretation is going to be used for identification of MI. Why? Because there's not a lot we can do for the right ventricular, left ventricular hypertrophy, you know, and things like that. But what can we do for MI? A good bit, right? Most importantly out of any intervention that we do is get the cath lab on alert so that when they get there, they can get into the cath lab and get opened up. So here's a couple of things that your book doesn't address, but I wanted to kind of address to you because of the importance of identification of, it may address it somewhat, but not the way this does, the importance of identification of MI. You want to minimize the time of the MI, the infarction, the start of the infarction, to the time of treatment. So you've got EMS to balloon time. The time from EMS patient contact, so the time that I get on that chest pain scene, to the time I do all my interventions and all that, and I get them in the cath lab. Or door to balloon time. This is going to be when they are walking in the door of the ER. They bypass 911. And then door to needle time, that may not be going into the cath lab necessarily to get a stent or a balloon, but they may be getting fibrinolytic medication. Nonetheless, it's important for us as paramedics, as pre-hospital professionals, to identify the fact that this patient's having chest pain, or we've got this gut feeling that something's going on, we've done a 12 lead, we've identified that we've got some type of MI, and we need to get them to the hospital. Currently, the AHA recommends a door to balloon time of less than 90 minutes and a door to needle time of less than 30 minutes. So that doesn't give EMS to definitive care that much time. So initially, if you've got an area that is becoming ischemic, and what would cause an area of the heart to start becoming ischemic? Not enough oxygen. We've got a clot in the coronaries somewhere, right? So initially, we might start seeing ST depressions, all right? So a QRS, we see inverted T wave, but as time goes on, see your J point? It starts rising, rising, rising until you get to infarction. And then sometimes with infarction, it may go back to normal, but you've got a prolonged QT interval. So what is the main reason why we do our Mona drugs and give nitrates and things like that? What? To dilate, to perfuse the heart, and to stop this progression. Once we start getting ischemia, we can actually reverse the ischemia. And then sometimes we can go back to where they have no type of issue. Us identifying this early and getting them into the cath lab quickly. But once we start getting down to injury, our next step is infarction, and infarction is death, right? Necrosis. Now, you've got a couple of different MIs. You've got the STEMI, which is just the wham bam, the J point's elevated like we just saw. You could have a non-STEMI. You could have a person sitting in front of you having an MI and not have any ST elevation. You could also have what's called a Q wave MI. Normally, you don't have a Q wave, right? Or you've got a very, very small Q wave. If you notice that when you do your 12-lead EKG, you've got a pretty obvious Q wave that's deep, then that may be either indication of a current MI, or it may be indication that they've had some type of injury in the past. So one of the first areas that we look at is the ST segment, the J point. If we have an ST segment that starts depressing below the isoelectric line, that's indicating ischemia. If it starts going above the isoelectric line, then we're starting to see injury. Remember, there's a difference in ischemia and injury. Ischemia may or could be reversed. Once we start getting injury, our next step is infarction, and that's cell death. All right? Very important to remember, time is muscle when it comes to MI management. So what are we looking for with ST segment elevation? 1 millimeter above the baseline in your limb leads, 2 millimeters above the baseline in your chest leads. What are your chest leads? V1 through V6, right? And again, what are we looking at in the chest leads? What area of the heart? The left ventricle. The left ventricle. So your T wave, your ST segment, and your T wave, that's going to be your most dynamic area during an infarct. And you can actually watch it progress. Sometimes you can actually watch that ST segment and that T wave progressing and changing. So some of the things that we're looking for. Ischemia, you may see T-wave inversion, ST segment depression, injury, you're going to start seeing ST elevation. So that's going to give you kind of an indication as to what point are we taking care of this patient while they're having an MI. And then after infarction, you may actually see Q-wave. So one of the things that we're looking at when we're looking at 12 lead is we're looking at anatomically contiguous leads. And we've already identified the anatomically contiguous leads by that little exercise that we did earlier when we circled the leads. So we want to look for patterns in the same area. So if I've got ST elevation in 2-3 AVF, that's going to indicate that I've got an MI where? The inferior wall, right? This is just another picture. Leads 2-3 AVF. Inferior wall, right? V1, V2, V3, V4. What did V1 and V2 look at? The septal wall. V3 and V4 looked at the anterior. So we're looking at the septum, then the anterior. So a lot of times you may have what's called an anterior septal MI because those are in kind of the same area. Then V1, AVL, or lead 1, AVL, V5, and V6 is looking at the lateral wall. So those are your contiguous leads. So with a normal 12 lead, we're just putting our leads on, we're looking at the left side. Does that mean that only the left side is involved in MI? No. We may have to do a right-sided 12 lead. Before I get into that, though, I want to talk about reciprocal changes. We want to look for contiguous leads, all right, V2, V3, AVF, lead 1, AVL, V5, V6, you know, we want to look in those areas, contiguous leads. And then we want to look at the opposite leads to see if we've got ST elevation in our contiguous leads. Then the opposite leads, we should see ST depression. These are called reciprocal changes. Reciprocal changes. So what that is I'm looking one way with my contiguous leads on the other side, or the other way that it's looking, it should be looking opposite, I should see a polar reflection in the other leads. Reciprocal ST segment depression, also known as reciprocal change, is defined as ST segment depression in leads separate and distinct from leads that reflect ST elevation. In other words, the concept of reciprocal change cannot be used if ST elevation is not present. So we're looking for ST elevation. The concept of reciprocal change cannot be used in patients with abnormal intraventricular conduction, including bundle branch blocks, pace rhythms, or hypertrophy, things like that. We'll get to the right ventricular stuff in just a minute, all right? So, if I told you, hey, you've got a lateral wall MI, What areas are you looking at?
V5,
V6, but also lead 1 and AVL. All right, so lead 1, AVL, V5, and V6. Inferior wall MI, we're looking at leads 2, 3, and AVF. And these are good pictures of just possible areas that you may have the blockage. If we're looking at the septal, V1 and V2, and then anterior, V3 and V4. So do you get the pattern here that we're looking at? We're looking at a topographical map, and we're associating the areas that we're looking at the heart with the areas that the infarct may or may not be. Not only are we looking at those particular areas, but we're getting an idea of what artery is involved as well, because there is somewhat of a different artery that supplies the different areas of the heart. Now, this is not 100% true, because everybody's anatomy is a little bit different. But for the most part, if you've got an anterior wall MI, you are going to have issues with your left anterior descending artery, which is a branch off of your left main, or your LCA, also known as the widowmaker. All right? So, I said that we're looking at the left side. If we want to get a right-sided EKG, we're going to have to put the leads a little bit differently so that we can take a look at the right side. You start with V4. You take V4 and you put it in the same spot on the right side of the chest, except opposite, right? Does that make sense? Now, you would hit acquire, but you would need to put R next to the V4. That would indicate you would get a 12 lead on the left side, and then if you felt like, hey, maybe there's some right side involvement, you would move your V4 to the right side, you would acquire a second 12 lead and write R on it so that you know that this is a right-sided look. Now, one of the things that's important for us to remember is that if we suspect MI, if we've got all the classic signs and symptoms, we might see some things that kind of jump out to us in the inferior wall, but nothing really on the left side, lateral, septal, anterior, anything like that. We probably want to go ahead and jump in and get a right-sided 12 lead. Because if we start treating that patient and they in fact do have a right-sided MI in the right ventricle, and we give them nitrates, and we give them morphine, and we dilate, we could actually cause more harm for that patient than good. Because if we vasodilate, then we're going to affect the pumping ability of the right side of the heart. So right-sided MIs should be identified, because that's going to make a determination as to how you treat your patient. Does that make sense? So, moving back, so that was just a little spill on right-sided, but we're mainly looking at left-sided. There's some reciprocal lead groups. Remember what we're looking for? We're looking for reciprocal changes. If we've got ST elevation in one, we should see ST depression on the other side. So if we see ST elevation leads 2, 3 AVF, then leads 1 and AVL, we should see depression. That's a reciprocal change. 2, 3 AVF leads V1 to V3. We may also see. Now, this talks about V7 to V9. That's if we do a 15 lead or an 18 lead ECG, and we're going to add more leads. We can't do a 15 or 18 lead ECG with just our 12 lead wires, some areas may have where you continue to move on towards the back, and then you can get a real good posterior view of the heart as well. All right? And that's described in your book. All right? So, this is just an example. Remember one of the things I said. If you've got ST elevation leads 2, 3, ABF, I'm going to look in leads 1, ABL, and what do I have? I've got depression, right? So I've got elevation here, I've got depression there. That's a reciprocal change. Are y'all somewhat getting this? Don't turn your minds off on this. Don't just get intimidated by all these new terms and reciprocal and contiguous and all that, because this is pretty important for good care. So what changes may you see? Especially if you have inferior MI, you might see reciprocal changes in leads 1 and ABL, and you may see an evolution of ST segment elevation. It may, you've got to keep a continuous monitor, and it may continue to get taller and taller and taller. Our goal is to keep it from doing that, because as ST elevation increases, what does that mean? That means that we're moving past ischemia, the cells are becoming injured, and then infarcted. So we've talked about these, and you got it wrote down in your paper there. So, let's say I've got a patient that is having chest pain. I hook them up to the monitor. I see ST elevation in V1, V2, maybe V3 and V4. That would be an anterolateral MI, right? What's my treatment? Remember Mona, but not in that order, right? Oxygen, aspirin, nitro, morphine. Now, why do we give morphine? Alright? We would give morphine even if the nitrates were working, alright? And we do give morphine as an added benefit of pain control. But it is also a vasodilator, and it decreases oxygen demand on the heart. So we're not just giving our narcotic, morphine, just for pain control. Right ventricular injury requires volume replacement prior to administration of nitrates, and I told you why. Why? We're going to help with preload because we may bottom their pressure out, we may affect their preload, and the right side's not going to have a whole lot to pump if we don't add some fluids to it. But we need to make sure it's the right sided MI. Alright? Make sure you're getting a 12 lead on all patients. STEMI, non-STEMI. Or you may just have a normal 12 lead. But if a patient has chest pain, if they give you that gut feeling that, hey, something's going on, then let's get a 12 lead and let's transmit it to the hospital. Make sense? We definitely want to identify early, and we need to let the hospital know, hey, we've got this coming in, because the only thing that's really going to minimize mortality and morbidity, injury and death, is if they don't spend a whole lot of time in the ER, and they go to that cath lab, and they get opened up. Okay? Mm-hmm. Most of y'all have been to cath lab and been able to see them go in. Did y'all get to see the dye, the radioactive dye being shot in and all that? It's a pretty neat little thing. All right. So, if a patient is ischemic, they may not benefit from emergency PCI, percutaneous coronary intervention, but that's not for us to decide. What we decide is, hey, this is something serious, we get them to the hospital. All right? Let's take a quick 5-minute break, and then we're going to come back and finish up. So you've got another algorithm that's added into your mix of the 5 or 6 basic ones that we talked about is your acute coronary syndrome algorithm. Now, if you look at this algorithm, it branches off 2 different treatment modalities. You've got your EMS and you've got your in-hospital. Bottom line is that the end result should be the same. Your EMS assessment and hospital preparation, of course, be prepared for MI or arrest if they've got symptoms suggestive of ischemia and infarction. Aspirin, mainstay, oxygen, nitro, and morphine is if needed. So, the approach to that, Millie pointed out to me just a minute ago, nitros first, nitrates first, as far as you've got your oxygen, aspirin, then nitro, and then if it's unrelieved, then morphine. Morphine's one of those drugs, though, that if they're not allergic to it, don't withhold it if they're still complaining of chest pain. If they're still showing some pretty big symptoms, breathing issues, things like that. Be sure you notify the hospital. Be sure that you transmit your 12 lead. Because they need to get ready for intervention, PCI, fibrinolytics, things like that. One of your responsibilities in the field is to fill out that fibrinolytic check sheet, especially if you're showing STEMI. Okay? And then it moves on down into several different tests and things like that. But your main role in this is early identification, getting them on a drug, telling them, getting a 12 lead acquired and transmitted, and getting them to the hospital. Any questions? Now, there's some other cardiovascular conditions that I'm just going to kind of run through real quick that could show some 12 lead EKG changes. Pulmonary embolism, hemorrhage, intracranial hemorrhage, electrolyte abnormalities. You've got what's called benign early repolarization, and it's going to be a fishhook look right there. If you see in the highlighted boxes there, this could be seen in the precordial leads and in inferior leads. What early repolarization, so what does that mean? It means that the ventricles have contracted, and now before they're completely done, they're going to start repolarizing. All right. Pericarditis could be one of those things that mimics chest pain, mimics MI. If they've got a history of recent infection or fever, and also, this is something that may be seen with IV drug users that use dirty needles. Because where does that bacteria go once it enters the bloodstream? To the heart, right? Characterized by diffuse ST segment elevation and a depressed PR. See that right there, depressed PR? So there's your isoelectric line. You've got ST elevation and depressed PR. Am I going to give you a 12 lead that has this and ask you to define pericarditis? No. All right. But these are some other conditions. Pulmonary embolism. this has a particular pattern called a S1, Q3, T3 pattern. Also may see right bundle branch block. An ST segment depression and lead to V1 and V3. So the S1, Q3, T3, a deep S wave in lead 1. Q3 is a deep narrow Q wave in lead 3. And T3 is a T wave inversion in lead 3. What is one of the what is characteristic of hypothermia that you may see that you wouldn't see in any other wave?
The J
wave or the Osborne wave. All right. So if you've got a patient that's hypothermic, you may see this Osborne wave. Remember we talked about electrolyte imbalances with hyperkalemia. You may see a tall pike spike T wave. Now, here's the thing is that you've got your QRS segment and you've got a tall spike T wave, but you don't really have a whole lot of like defined ST elevation. So you would look at this, and if you saw a tall spike T wave, you're going to be kind of thinking, hey, maybe this is hyperkalemia. On the flip side, you may see hypokalemia, where it's a flat or absent T wave and a U wave. So what you would see is a PQRS T wave that's kind of flattened, then another little wave, and then a start over of a PQRS T wave. Right?
What's the U wave?
Hypokalemia. It's going to be part of the repolarization. And then calcium deficits. Why? Just think about it just in terms of what calcium does with the myocardial cells. Why might you have a shortened QT interval if you have hypercalcemia? So think about it. QT. So you got a shortened.
It's
contracting too hard, too quick, because you got too much calcium. On the flip side of that, if you don't have enough, you're not getting a good contraction. It's going to take longer. Okay? Cardiomyopathy. Myocardial walls become very thick. So we, depending on what side the cardiomyopathy is, we're going to expect some really big T waves. I mean, R waves, if it's like on the left side, especially more towards V3, V4, V5, V6. If it's on the right side, we may see it more in V1 and V2. Brugada syndrome. Characterized by what you see here, it's a disorder involving sodium channels in the heart. When you leave paramedic school, you can at least say, hey, I heard the word Brugada syndrome before. This is getting a little bit deeper than what we need to really get into. Long QT syndrome. What drug, and it's a common drug, that people may take for cardiac issues could increase the QT interval. Huh? Digitalis. So a person with digitalis overdose may have a long QT. So what is a long QT? What does that mean? It means the ventricles are taking a long time to depolarize and repolarize. Then you can start getting into some issues as far as your absolute refractory periods, your relative refractory periods, and R on T phenomenon. Remember that term, R on T phenomenon? So while the ventricles are repolarizing, we may start a whole new cardiac cascade or a whole new cardiac depolarization. And now I've got depolarization of the atria while my right ventricle is still repolarizing. That could lead to ventricular fibrillation. Alright, so we've talked a good bit about emergency medical care, so let's just practice a couple. So first off, let's just start with the bottom, lead two. What's something that just absolutely jumps out to you? ST elevation. So we want to look in the contiguous leads. What are the contiguous leads to lead two? Leads 2, 3, AVF. So look in leads 3 and AVF. What do you see? All right. What were the reciprocal leads to leads 2, 3, AVF? 1 and AVL. So lead 1, we don't see a ton of depression, but look in AVL. We do see some reciprocal change there, right? Now, what's something that you also notice about lead 3 and AVL as far as other waves are concerned? See a Q wave here? So if you see a Q wave that's deeper than about one small box, then that means that there is some type of issue, right? Because think about how it supposed to go. You got your P wave, then you got just a small little thing, and then it goes up. But in that situation, you got your P wave, and then you got a deep Q wave, and then it goes up into your R. All right. So I've got ST elevation leads 2-3 AVF, congruent leads or contiguous leads. And then I've also got some reciprocal changes. I've got some other things that jump out, a Q wave. Where is the location of the infarct? Inferior. Does that make sense? Let's just look at our V1 through V6 really quickly. Mostly negative. It's becoming more positive, more positive, more positive, positive, positive. So I think our progression here is looking okay. Now, we would also want to look for reciprocal changes in V5 and V6, and there's not really any big reciprocal changes in V5 and V6. All right? Remember, leads 1, AVL, V5, and V6 would be your reciprocal views of your 2-3 AVF. Okay? So here's your ST elevation in 2-3 AVF. Q wave formation. There's a white arrow right here. See the Q wave? And then you've got a reciprocal ST depression. Okay, so I kind of put it together a little bit. So we're going to say this is an inferior MI. On this one, I didn't give you a lead, a 6-second lead across the bottom, but you can just start in your areas, right? If you want to start in V1, then you would need to look in V1, AVL, V5, and V6. Then move on to your inferior. So go in your particular areas. All right. What do you see that might jump out at you? All right, V2, V3, V4, V1 as well. V1 has ST. If this is your baseline, you do have ST elevation there. Yep. All right, so ST elevation is maximal. V1 and V2 are your septal leads. V3 and V4 are your anterior leads. You also see some Q waves in V1 and V2. So, what type of MI? What areas of the heart? So this could be a anteroseptal MI, right? All right. Ready to move to the next one? What is one of the things that jumps out? V1 and V2. Very large QRS complex. We've got this terminal S wave. It terminates without forming a full wave here. Terminal R wave in V1, AVL and V6. V1, AVL, V6. So you don't have a complete S wave and an R wave that stops in the S wave. So this would be a left bundle branch block. Now what's another thing that I told you you can look at to determine that it's a left side? Yes. If you look at your J point here, the wave that's before it is a negative deflection or it's going down. Okay? Practice 4. You've got a broad QRS. A R prime pattern here. Alright. And a wide slurred S wave in your lateral leads. Now this takes a little bit of time to really kind of get your mind around. But this would be considered a right bundle branch block. And remember, look at your J point here. How is that wave deflected? It's upright, right? So it's going up. Using the turn signal, that would indicate a right bundle branch.
In V3, you've also got negative deflection URF.
Yes, and it may be, but lead 3 alone isn't going to give you the determination. You've got to look in your your chest lead. Okay? Putting your stuff up, get out a sheet of paper. We're going to do just a quick little quiz on this. You can use whatever notes you take.